Labor's reign in Queensland has come to an end. Liberal leader David Crisafulli today being sworn in as the state's 41st Premier. And the Premier-elect joins us now live from Brizzy for more. Congratulations, David. It's been a neck-and-neck race, hasn't it? It was such a slow count Saturday night. Was it a drama for you to wait until Sunday morning?
Good morning, Carl. It was a slow count, but the result exceeded even our expectations. And we put forward a plan for Queenslanders and they backed it, right? So we get to work. And we were at work yesterday. We've appointed an acting director general. And I want Queenslanders to know the plan we took forward is the plan we're going to focus on. Youth crime, health, housing, cost of living. They will see change. We asked them to vote for a fresh start. They did. And work got underway yesterday. And there'll be more of it today.
You're committing to act on youth crime laws before Christmas. There is, even this morning on our show with Jackie Lambie, a fair bit of scepticism around the effectiveness of that plan, and it's almost November. You've got to crack on.
Yeah, but I've made the commitment and I'll deliver it. And I think there's been growing distrust in politics because people haven't followed through what they say they're going to do. I take a vastly different approach. If I say I'm going to do something, I do it. And if I say I'm not going to do something, I won't do it. So let me assure your viewers exactly the same thing I said before the election. By the end of the year, the Making Queensland Safer laws will be laws. Adult crime will be adult time in this state. Now, we've also got to get cracking on early intervention and rehabilitation when kids leave prison as well. I'm not going to give up on kids. They need hope, they need opportunity, they need discipline, but they also need consequences for actions. And those laws are going to be laws by Christmas. There's no wriggle room, there's no ifs, no buts, no maybes. They're going to be law.
We don't have clarity on the Olympic Games yet. You don't want to use CUSAC as a venue, and I don't blame you. What are you going to do then? Where will you host the athletes?
We're underway, and within 100 days, Queenslanders will see through that Independent Infrastructure Coordination Authority a plan that they're proud of. And I want Queenslanders to know that we do have time, and yes, it would have been great to have delivered something, and we were awarded the Olympic Paralympic Games 1,200 days ago, but no one's going to benefit me looking at the past and just criticising the former government. I've asked for 100 days and we'll deliver it within 100 days. We're going to get the best and brightest around that table and we are going to deliver generational infrastructure for this state. And at the moment, when I talk to Queenslanders about the Games, they say, I just don't want to be embarrassed. I don't want to be embarrassed on the world stage. Well, it's not about embarrassed. It's about an opportunity. It's about excitement and we want to create that. And I want to create that for every part of Queensland. And I promise people, you're going to see a plan that people buy into and it will create generational infrastructure for this state.
Okay.
And people will look back on it as a turning point. But we do have time and we will deliver on time.
Measured up against cost of living pressures as well, so there's a lot to take into account. Are you going to elevate more women in a cabinet?
I said that the team I took to the election will be the team after the election, Carl. But I'll tell you what we have done. We've elected a generation of candidates, the likes of which Queenslanders should be really, really proud of. And I made a commitment to people that there would be more women, more young people, more people from small and family business background, more people from culturally diverse backgrounds, and we delivered on that. And it looks like we've elected the youngest woman ever to the Queensland Parliament. Now, that's a big deal. During the campaign, she was attacked by her political opponents because she was a young woman. And I think we need time to reflect on that, how ridiculous that could be in the modern political era.
All right,
we have elected some amazing people. They will be stars of the future.
How do you feel about Peter Dutton's nuclear plan? Any wriggle room there for the big boss?
No, Carl, and I've been upfront about that, but we won't agree on everything. He's a Broncos fan, I'm a Cowboys fan. Doesn't mean that we'll agree on everything, but I've been upfront about that with him, and he's been upfront with me. And there's a lot we do agree on as well. And most importantly, I want your viewers to know that the relationship with Canberra will be reset because what I've seen in recent times from the former government is they took a different approach when it was the blue team in power to the red team. And I don't think people want to see that. People just want to see me going into bat for Queensland and they'll get that. And my relationship with Mr. Albanese and Mr. Dutton will be the same. It'll be respectful, but it'll also be forceful. And I think that's the way that people want to see their premiers approach business.
Get to it. Thank you so much for being on the show. Appreciate it. Queensland's new Premier will officially be sworn in today, ending Labor's near 10-year grip over the state.
Labor leaders across the country are on notice amidst a potential Liberal wave. We have team coverage for you this morning. Let's go first to Today Queensland reporter Andrea Crothers at Queensland State Parliament. Andrea, a busy time ahead as David Crisafulli assumes his new role.
Hey guys, if the campaign was full throttle, now the real work begins. The Premier-elect has a massive agenda, particularly for his first 100 days in the state's top job. But first, he must head to Government House this morning, where he'll be officially sworn in as Queensland's 41st Premier. He and the Deputy Leader, Jared Blay, will take on interim roles in the ministry before the full cabinet is sworn in later this week. The LNP leader already under pressure to elevate more women in that cabinet. Currently, there are just six people in that 19-person shadow ministry. One of the difficulties is, though, David Crisafulli had vowed that he would keep the same team if he were to take power. Now he is preparing for his first sitting fortnight as well, where he plans to introduce those new youth crime laws, which were a centrepiece of their campaign. As for Stephen Miles, well, he has put his hand up to lead Labor in opposition, something he looks set to do after what has been, by all accounts, an impressive campaign. For the party itself, though, plenty of soul-searching, particularly where they suffered the most damage in those regions and suburbs, guys.
All right, Andrea, thank you. Let's bring in Today Federal Politics reporter now, Liz Daniels from Canberra. Liz, good morning. It's a coalition win, so does that leave the federal government wanting?
Well, Sarah, a state result doesn't always directly translate to federal level, but Labor will be nervous knowing that Queensland is critical to Anthony Albanese's re-election hopes. Let's have a look at the way the state-by-state results have gone over the last decade. 10 years ago, South Australia and Tasmania were the only Labor states. Then this red wave begins. Victoria in 2014, the first to flip. The next to go is the Northern Territory, Queensland, and then the Northern Territory turns red, followed by Western Australia, that was in 2017. And then by 2023, every mainland state is under Labor rule. New South Wales was the last to fall. Tasmania remains the holdout. Now in 2024, we're seeing that tide start to turn back. The Northern Territory and Queensland have just re-elected new Liberal governments. The next to go to an election will be Western Australia. The Liberals there do face an uphill battle, but that's likely to come before potentially a federal election. Of course, Peter Dutton will be buoyed by this win in his home state, where he consistently sees strong polling results. For Anthony Albanese and Labor, the swings were particularly dire in regional Queensland, now many are pointing to cost of living relief promises from Stephen Miles that have helped to potentially curb an even bigger move to the Liberals. The thing that both of these men will be pleased with is that the Greens suffered big time on Saturday, opening the door for the Liberals and Labor to both claw back inner city Brisbane seats that they lost to the minor party back in 2022. Sarah.
All right, Liz, thank you.